Now that we understand what a program is in a general way, it is time to get more detailed about how computers are able to understand the Java programs we write. It turns out that several layers of translation occur before we can even execute or run our programs. After we talk about that, we will look at what happens when our program is actually running. In order to explain how computers understand the Java code we write, we need to know a bit, excuse the pun, about how computers represent information. As you may have heard before, most modern digital computers process and store information using zeros and ones, also known as binary. Now, this isn't a computer science course, but I want to be clear that computers don't literally use the symbols 0 and 1 to get their work done. Most digital computers typically use higher or lower ranges of voltages to represent 0 and 1, or on and off. The reason we use the symbols 0 and 1 as representations of something like a high or low voltage is that it allows us humans to use mathematics to understand, design, and manipulate our digital computers. If that did not make much sense, do not worry at all. The truth is, languages like Java hide most of these details from us application developers. The key point I was trying to make is that digital computers cannot understand high-level programming languages, such as Java, in their original state. Therefore, all high-level, human-readable programming languages must be compiled, which is another word for translated, into binary. The actual process to go from the Java code we will write to some kind of executable binary language is quite complex, so I will only give you a simplified overview. First, the Java code, which is written in files that have the .java file extension, are given to a program called JavaC, which is a shorthand name for the Java compiler. JavaC will take the code that we have written and reproduce it in Java bytecode files, which have the .class file extension. Once the Java bytecode is created, the next step is that the bytecode will be given to a Java virtual machine, or JVM for short. There are many different JVMs which are written for different operating systems, such as Windows, Mac, or Linux, and I will discuss them further in the next lesson. For now, understand that the JVM will take our class files and translate them into something which the operating system itself can execute. Fortunately, the programs we typically use to write our applications will handle jobs like compilation for us. Even so, it is helpful to know a bit about this process. What we just talked about explains what happens just before an application is deployed, and we refer to that time frame as the compile time in an application's lifecycle. Now we will talk about the time frame when an application is actually running on a computer, which we call runtime. At this point, I'm going to try to explain what happens in a computer when a program is actually running. Rather than describing this process using a bunch of big words, I will try to give you a visual way of understanding things. Now, in order to keep this appropriate for beginners, I will have to leave out many details on how the different parts of a computer, namely the CPU and the computer's memory, really work. Later on in your career, you may wish to study a book like Operating Systems: Three Easy Pieces to learn about CPU memory virtualization and other advanced topics. I want you to imagine for a moment that the memory of a computer is itself a virtual three or two dimensional space, kind of like a video game world. You might also think of it as being something similar to your own mental workspace, which you use to solve problems and design things. When your program is executed and runtime begins, an unused portion of the whole memory space is allocated or provided to your running program. We typically call a running program a process, in case you have ever looked at a task manager and wondered what the list of processes was all about. What gets created in this virtual memory space depends on the different instructions we have given to the computer via the Java code we write. For example, in the application I will be using as a teaching tool in several lessons, one of the first instructions, also known as methods, which is executed is called start. Do not worry about understanding everything going on here just yet. The only thing I want you to notice is these new keywords. The new keyword is one of the ways in which we create objects in memory space. I will revisit this word object later, but a good way to think about it is to imagine a real-world object such as a person. By the time these instructions have completed, All of these different objects, each which have different names and jobs I have given to them, are sitting in memory space, waiting for the user to start interacting with them. As the user begins to interact with them, they will start to send messages, crunch numbers, store progress, and begin redrawing the user interface appropriately. The main point of this lesson is to give you a way to think about your programs not just as a bunch of lines of text, but as a virtual world where different objects pop in and out of existence during runtime. You, as the programmer, dictate what these objects are called, what their structure looks like, what problems they solve, and the relationships between them. Thinking of a running program like a company full of employees or a bunch of little robots solving problems and sending messages to each other may help you to design your programs more effectively without worrying about the keywords and syntax until later. That's enough for now, but for a sneak preview, in part 5 of this course, I will teach you exactly how to design these little robots systematically and effectively.